Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus. Amen. Here in the book of Genesis, the Lord appeared to Abraham near the great trees of Mamre while he was sitting at the entrance to his tent in the heat of the day. So here's Abraham relaxing. Then three travelers walk by. Then the custom of that day, the person there would see a visitor or a traveler and would open their home to them, offering water to wash the feet and to help them with their thirst, to offer food, refreshment, rest. This was a custom of the day. So Abraham, being a man of the day, followed that custom. They offered these travelers hospitality. And when the Lord and his two guests accepted Abraham's offer, now all kinds of stuff starts happening. Abraham gets up quickly and he hurries into the tent. Sarah, get three seahs of fine flour and knead it and make some bread. Just to give you a little perspective, three seahs is about 36 pounds of fine flour, 24. It's a lot of flour. So you can only imagine how much work that Sarah would have to do to knead all that flour and make all that bread. And then after that, Abraham runs out into the field, goes to his herd, and selects a tender, choice calf. And then he takes the calf hurriedly to a servant, who then prepares this in a rush so that this food can be set before the Lord and his two companions. And then when the meal was placed there before the Lord and the two companions, and Abraham went over, stood underneath the tree while they ate. Again, the custom of the day. Let the visitors eat while I stand over here in the shadow. While we, the Lord confirms the promise that he's already made Abraham times before, that he, Abraham, and his wife Sarah will have a son. The Lord says to Abraham, I will come back in about a year's time. And before then, Sarah will conceive and she will give birth to a healthy little boy, your heir. Now, Sarah, after all that work, was standing in the entrance of the tent behind Abraham and the Lord and his companions. She hears this. Ha ha, she says. Me, now that I'm old and worn out, and here's Abraham even older, we're going to have a child, this pleasure comes to me. Ha, no way. Now, maybe it was because Sarah tired and distracted from making all that bread. Maybe it was just all the time that had passed in her age, but somehow she was not able to focus and hear and believe and trust the Lord's promise. And you and I can get distracted. And just like Sarah, maybe we find it hard to believe the Lord's promise. But the Lord told Sarah, Abraham, and he tells us, is anything too hard for the Lord? Of course not. Now in our gospel, we hear another example of hospitality. As Jesus and his disciples were on their way, he came to a village where a woman named Martha opened her home to him. Again, being hospitable, here's Martha opening her home to Jesus and his disciples. Now, she's not like Abraham. I don't know for a fact, but I'm pretty sure that Martha was not very rich. She certainly doesn't have a husband. She just has her sister. So what does Martha have to do? She can't run and tell her husband to do this or run out into the field. So here's Martha doing all the preparations herself, expecting her sister to help her. But what's her sister doing? Her sister Mary sat at the Lord's feet, listening to what he said. Don't you care that my sister has left me to do the work by myself? Tell her to help me. Now here's Martha wanting to be, and I believe she was probably being a very good hostess. But here is Jesus, right in front of her, right in her home. And she's so distracted that she must give him food, give him water, these things, that she's not even listening to him and his teaching. But Jesus calms her and reminds her of that one most important thing. Jesus says, Martha, Martha, you are worried and upset about many things, but only one thing is needed. Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken away from her. See, Martha was distracted, believing that hospitality was most important. With Jesus right in front of her, right in her home, she wasn't listening to Jesus. And then Sarah, perhaps being distracted from all the work she had to do to prepare the bread, or maybe it was just her age, or how long that she had not conceived, she found it laughable to listen to and believe the Lord's promise. Now you and I might get distracted. Maybe simple things distract us. Just this morning, you know, we had a little bit of a rain. That might have distracted some people to decide not to come to worship. Or, you know, right now, our youth and thousands, literally thousands of young boys and girls, young men and women are in New Orleans at the National Youth Gathering, chaperones and mentors and all sorts of people. Think of all the preparation. And what is the gathering? It's a gathering to focus these people, these young people and old, at that one thing, Jesus and his reconciliation, his life for us. But maybe in all those preparations, they think more about how something has to look or how it needs to be presented than to actually think about Jesus. Or maybe there's something good that happened. Maybe it's your favorite team won the game or the championship, or maybe a son or a daughter has graduated, or maybe there's a wedding shower or a baby shower. You know, all these good things might distract us away from our eyes focused on Jesus. Or maybe it's something that's not so happy. Maybe it's an illness or it's a death. Now we have a void in our life because the loved one has gone away, and we're distracted by that. And we don't think about the joy of that eternal life for that person who has passed into eternal life with Jesus. So many distractions in life can take our eyes off of Jesus, take our focus off of his life, his suffering, his death, and his resurrection. And we forget about that one most needful thing. But St. Paul helps bring us back. He reminds us that once we were alienated from God and were enemies in our minds because of our evil behavior. But now, he, God, has reconciled us by Christ's physical body through death to present us holy in his sight without blemish and free from accusation. You see, we may get distracted. God recognizes that. We may not live the perfect life. God recognizes that. And this is why Jesus came in the flesh to live as you and I. But unlike you and me, Jesus never was distracted. He remained completely focused on God's will. He always sought God's face. And knowing God's will is that you and I and every person shall be reconciled to God. This is God's will. Jesus knew and knows God's will. Therefore, he lived that perfect, sinless life that you and I can, so that he would then offer his perfect, sinless body to death in our place conclude this sermon with a prayer, following the prayer in Psalm 27. Dear Father, thank you for knowing exactly what it is I need, that we all need, that we cannot fully remain focused in your will, that we do become distracted, and therefore your one and only Son came in the flesh to live that perfect life for us, so that all of your promises are fulfilled in him, and he is the way, the truth, and the life. I pray. When illness or death come into life, you, Lord, are my salvation and my life. Whom shall I fear? You, Lord, are the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? And when decisions or laws, Lord, are passed that are contrary to your Lord, remind me, when evil men advance against me to devour my flesh, when my enemies and my foes attack me, they will stumble and fall. And dear Father, when there is persecution of any follower of Jesus because of his name, anywhere in the world or even here in the United States, remind me, though an army besiege me, my heart will not fear. Though war break out against me, even then will I be confident. And dear Father, when good fortune comes my way, remind me, one thing I ask of the Lord, this is what I seek, that I may dwell in your house all my days, to gaze upon your beauty, Lord, and to seek you in your temple. For in the day of trouble, you will keep me safe. Dear Father, when I'm distracted by doubt and I forget your promises, in that day of trouble, you will keep me safe in your dwelling, and you will hide me in your shelter, in your tabernacle, and you will set me high upon a rock. Then my head will be exalted above the enemies who surround me, and your tabernacle I will sacrifice with shouts of joy. I will sing and make music to you, Lord. And dear Father, when those temptations come, when that pet sin of mine pulls me away from you, remind me to pray. Hear my voice when I call, O Lord. Be merciful to me and answer me. My heart says to you, seek your face, Lord. Your face, Lord, I will seek. And when I turn away, do not hide your face from me, dear Father. Do not turn me away in anger. You have been my helper. Do not reject me or forsake me, O God, my Savior. Remind me always, dear Father, to seek your face first, to keep my eyes focused on Jesus and the reconciliation he has given me and all believers because of his life, his perfect life, his death. And keep me confident of this, that I will see the goodness of you, Lord, in the land of the living, that I will wait for you, Lord, that I will be strong and take heart and wait for you, Lord. Amen. And may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and minds in true faith.